speciation and extinction. To help you study, I've put together a checklist that you can download at apbiosuccess.com/checklist. What is the biological species concept and what are some of its limitations? The biological species concept defines a species as a group of organisms that can naturally interbreed to produce viable, meaning healthy, fertile, meaning able to reproduce, offspring, and which is reproductively isolated from other such groups. Here is an example of one species. There are different breeds of dogs, but the dogs don't care. Left to their own devices, they'll interbreed and they'll produce viable, fertile offspring. These two species of ducks, by contrast, don't interbreed, or at least they interbreed to such a small degree that their gene pools are separate. The concept is not perfect, and it falters in a couple of cases. The first is in the case of closely related species, which can often hybridize. They can often interbreed, but not so much, so the gene pools maintain relative separateness. Extinct or asexual species, how could you tell if they could produce fertile or viable offspring? And prokaryotic species. What are reproductive isolating mechanisms? Compare and contrast pre- and postzygotic forms of isolation. Reproductive isolating mechanisms are processes, behaviors, or other traits that keep the gene pools of closely related species separate. Mallards, pintails, they're both ducks. How do they maintain separate gene pools? There are two kinds of barriers. The first are prezygotic isolating mechanisms, and they prevent breeding altogether. They prevent the formation of a zygote. Postzygotic barriers exist between species that are close enough to mate and form a zygote, but formation of a zygote doesn't ultimately lead to the production of successful individuals, viable individuals, who can survive and produce offspring themselves. Let's look at prezygotic isolating mechanisms. The first kind is behavioral. Different mating rituals or courtship behaviors would keep a female and a male from accepting one another as members of the same species and mating. Temporal means that they would breed during different times of the day or different seasons. One species mates in the winter, another mates in the summer. They're not going to interbreed. Mechanical, structural barriers that prevent sperm or pollen from reaching an egg. If the flower structure is very different, then a pollinator wouldn't be able to bring pollen from one flower to another flower. Habitat. One species lives in the forest, another lives in a meadow. One species lives in the uplands, another lives in the lowlands. They won't meet each other in order to breed. And finally, gametic. The egg won't allow fertilization because there's some molecular mismatch that would keep the sperm from being able to bind with the egg and induce the kind of changes that lead to fertilization. List and describe three postzygotic isolating mechanisms. Postzygotic barriers can exist between species that are close enough to mate and form a zygote, but nevertheless, their gene pools remain separate. These can include hybrid inviability. The hybrid organisms don't develop. There might be hybrid sterility. The hybrid offspring are healthy, but they can't reproduce. That's what's going on between horses and donkeys, which can interbreed to produce mules, but the mules themselves are sterile. Finally, there's hybrid breakdown. The hybrids are healthy and can reproduce, but the next generation, the F2s, are inviable or infertile. Contrast allopatric and sympatric modes of speciation. Allopatric speciation involves a geographic barrier. It's what's shown over here in number one. Sympatric speciation occurs without a geographical barrier, as shown over here in number two. Your success in AP Biology starts here. Are you struggling with AP Bio? With learn-biology.com, students get the skills and confidence to be a top student and earn fours and fives on the AP Bio exam guaranteed. Go to learn-biology.com to find out how you can master your biology course and crush the AP Bio exam. In allopatric speciation, geographical isolation leads to genetic differentiation, which leads to reproductive isolation. In stage one, a species is spread out over a geographical range. There's gene flow between any subpopulations. In stage two, some kind of geographic barrier, like this shown at B, arises and it splits the species apart, so there's no longer gene flow between these two isolated populations. In stages two and three, environmental differences result in different selective pressures, which lead to genetic differentiation. There's mutation happening, and the environment is selecting which variants are going to be more favorable in each different environment. And finally, when that barrier disappears, the two formerly subspecies have become so different that they can no longer interbreed. They were geographically separated, now they're reproductively isolated by any of the mechanisms that we've just discussed. Sympatric speciation can occur in animals and plants. In plants, there can be sympatric speciation through polyploidy. This can lead to changes in chromosome numbers, causing instant one-generation reproductive isolation between the newly emerged species and its parent species. One example of sympatric speciation in animals involves the hundreds of species of these fish that are called cichlids that live in Africa's Lake Victoria. What is thought is that sexual selection has led to reproductive isolation between the subspecies. That's been experimentally verified. It's a very complex story, and what I want to encourage you to do is go look at the case study on learn-biology.com. The link is below. Here's another mechanism of sympatric speciation in animals. Adaptation to specific microhabitats can also lead to reproductive isolation and speciation, such as the evolution of a variety of lice that inhabit different parts of birds. This is kind of astonishing, but there are lice that, for example, live only on the head of an albatross, and there are different species that live on the wings. There are other species of lice that only live on the heads of parrots, while others live on the wings of parrots. These are different species, and they are in different parts of the bird, and you might say, well, for a little louse, well, maybe that's like a mountain, but that doesn't count as allopatric speciation. There's no geographic barrier. All of these lice are just becoming extraordinarily specialized as they adapt to different parts of these birds. And these specializations are getting passed on, and that's leading to speciation over time. So sympatric speciation in animals because of microhabitat adaptation. What is adaptive radiation? This is a concept that we dealt with earlier when we talked about the evolution of homologous features. Adaptive radiation occurs when one parent species produces several descendant species, each of which has unique adaptations and fills a different ecological niche. The 14 species of Galápagos finches shown here, all of which are descendants of a single South American species, are an example. This one species arrived at the Galápagos Islands and then radiated into a whole variety of descendants, each of which has different features, each of which has a different ecological niche. Phylogeny is a reflection of adaptive radiation. Each of the different branches show splitting from a common ancestor. That's adaptive radiation on a very large scale. Finally, homologous and vestigial traits, which we talked about in the context of evidence for evolution, are also a result of adaptive radiation. It's about splitting from a common ancestor and subsequent descent with modification. Here are your next moves for AP Bio success. Please subscribe to learn-biology.com and please watch this next video.